The Worst Thing I've Done by Ursula Hegi, narrated by Gabra Zackman and Oliver Wyman.
Chapter 1. Annie, Talk Radio. Tonight, Annie is driving from North Sea to Montauk and back to North Sea as she has every night since Mason killed himself. She turns on the radio, finds Dr. Francine, listening to people so desperate that they confess their misery to radio psychologists, distracts Annie from the rope cutting into Mason's graceful neck, his flat ears lovely even in death. Distracts her for a few minutes, but only late at night, alone in her car, when she can be as anonymous as those callers. Annie switches between Dr. Francine and Dr. Virginia during long commercials for anti-itch powder and ointments guaranteed to cure various sores. Dr. Virginia is snappy, cuts people off, tells them the solutions to their problems before they finish describing their problems. But Dr. Francine's voice is soothing. Whenever she sighs, you can feel her compassion, even for those callers who go on and on. Like this shaky voice now, Linda from Walla Walla, Washington, talking about shrimp.
Everyone in Walla Walla knows. 52 years ago, I stole a bag of shrimp from the grocery store. I don't know why, Dr. Francine. I was looking at them on display, so curved and so pink.
There's something oddly sexual in Linda's description of the curved pink flesh. A pink curved longing. Dr. Francine sighs. Annie can tell she's a good listener. Imagines a gentle face, lined and intelligent.
It's the only time I ever stole anything, doctor. The store manager, she told me to unzip my coat.
Annie turns from Taud Point onto Noyack Road. Clear. The sky, too. Clear, with just a fist of clouds around the moon.
Because that's where I was hiding the shrimp, inside my fur coat. Not real mink, Dr. Francine. Fun fur. The manager said she'd see me in court, but no one came for me, though I kept waiting, and all along my husband's mother saying she warned him before he married me. Lately.
Yes, Linda.
Lately, I've had the feeling everyone is talking about me and those shrimp.
Even after half a century? Dr. Francine asks softly.
I've stopped leaving my house because people are teasing me about it.
What do they say to you, Linda?
Oh, nothing directly to me, really.
Space cookie heaven. Mason's voice. From inside the radio? No. That's why Annie is in the car. To get away from him. The steering wheel vibrates under her palms as the speedometer zooms to 50 on the winding road. Space cookie heaven.
Mason, humming Twilight Zone inside Annie's head.
Fuck off, Mason. In my heart, I'll always be married to you.
That's so
arrogant. Her headlights skim across a diamond-shaped road sign with the silhouette of a deer leaping left to right. Always left to right. She's on the stretch of road with water on both sides. For an instant, she wonders, would it stop her rage if she were to twist the steering wheel to the right and slide into North Sea Harbor?
Not for me.
She taps the brakes. Having a child didn't stop Mason. With him, there always was that wildness. That fiery energy Annie used to love because it electrified their marriage. But for her, all wildness ended 8 years ago, when Opal was born. That's why she drives fast, but not dangerously so, because of Opal, who is finally asleep at Aunt Stormy's house in North Sea, where they've stayed in the 17 days since Mason's death. Some nights it takes hours to get Opal settled because she keeps calling Annie to her bed. Knee aches, headaches, ache aches, all kinds of little complaints to bring Annie back to her. Tonight, a thumb ache. And when Annie held her, she felt Opal shiver, felt her own fierce love for Opal like a shiver, a blink throughout her body, always part of her. Burn in hell, you bastard, for doing this. Mason's parents arranged his funeral.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.